Soon after the advent of powered flight in 1903, the new flying machines were adapted to take to the air from sheltered waters. Then followed a five-decade period during which commercial flying boats were employed for short-distance military and commercial purposes, and then for the new fast carriage of mail and passengers to and from far-flung outposts of the British Empire. In the history of aviation, it was the flying boats that were the first all-metal aircraft, had the first automatic pilot, and the first in-flight meal services. Then, after 50 years of sterling service, they were gone, superseded by economical and pressurized land planes.
Within 30 years of the first flight, you had passengers being taken across the world in an aeroplane. Unthinkable.
Before the war, and for about 7 or 8 years after the war, most of the airports were very inadequate. I mean, a few of the large cities like London, Paris, New York had their airports, but the rest of the airports in the world were really nothing more than mown grass fields.
Prior to World War II, if you got a light dew, the whole mascot would be a swamp.
They gave insufficient space for a land plane to take off with a heavy load of fuel and then be able to fly the long distances required on overseas routes. So the flying boat, operating from harbours and lakes, had almost unlimited runway.
They were big, slow, noisy, because all the soundproofing was non-existent.
When we were running up engines in Rose Bay, people used to come down the front at Lion Park and they'd be queued up 3 and 4 deep, just watching us run up the engines. It was incredible.
And to sit in the cockpit of the flying boat was quite awesome.
I look upon the flying boats today, even today, as just a wonderful era to pass through. Commercially today, you pack as many people in your aircraft as possible and fly it from go to woe. But in those days, it was quite different to today.
It was just a complete different world to ordinary aerodromes and ordinary sort of aeroplanes.
It had maritime routes in that, you know, it operated from the sea, which is an ancient thing. But it also did this amazingly modern thing of actually lifting off the sea and going into the sky.
There's a certain magic about seeing a flying boat tearing along the water with the spray flying out behind it.
The ferry 3D seaplane seen here was first employed by the Royal Australian Navy in 1919. By 1921, it was also in the aircraft inventory of the Royal Australian Air Force, who employed it to gain the distinction of completing the first ever circumnavigation of Australia. Carrying a crew of 2 Air Force aviators over a grueling period of 44 days, the flight won the Britannia Challenge Trophy, the first such British awarding of an overseas aviation achievement. The difference between a seaplane, like the ferry, and a flying boat is that a seaplane fuselage sits above the water on a carriage supported by floats. The flying boat has the hull of a boat instead of a fuselage, which rests fully in the water, supported on either side by underwing floats. The first military flying boat converted for the carriage of British passengers was a 1919 Supermarine Channel. The new British aviation industry was booming, and the government decided to rationalise it in 1923 by merging 5 aviation companies to form Imperial Airways, which then became the official airline of the UK. Also at this time, the first purpose-built passenger flying boat was brought into service. Named the Sea Eagle, travellers enjoyed the innovation of an enclosed cabin during new services to the Channel Islands. By 1925, the Australian ferry seaplanes were ageing, and the RAAF placed an order for 6 new British Supermarine Seagull Mark III flying boats. These aircraft are amphibious, employing wheels as well as floats to enable operation from land bases. The Seagulls were used in survey and reconnaissance work by Navy cruisers. The Seagull IIIs were hoisted to and from the water by ship's crane. During 1928, another world achievement in aviation attracted public attention. 4 Supermarine Southamptons of the RAF Far East flight arrived in Melbourne on a circumnavigation and flag-waving mission. The RAF crews were warmly received during their visit, and the flight was considered proof that flying boats had evolved to become a reliable means of long-distance transport. Also in 1928, 2 wooden hull Southampton flying boats were delivered to the RAAF by the British manufacturers Short Brothers. These graceful, slow-moving aircraft began operations from RAAF Point Cook as the nucleus of a coastal reconnaissance flight. One of them was used as a platform for parachute training, and many RAAF personnel of the day made their first descents from the outboard wing platforms.
I take it that you all thoroughly understand what you are to do. Are there any questions? All right, gentlemen, break off and carry on with the program.
The RAAF base at Point Cook in Victoria began in 1914 as the Central Flying School, and by 1923 it had commenced an official cadet training program. It grew into a respected training organization, which was to equip thousands of personnel for wartime flying duties. A significant number of these young men were to receive wartime postings to flying boat squadrons.
We were flying the very early versions of DH-60G de Havilland Moss, and we went on to Westland Wapitis, which were much bigger biplanes, and I eventually finished my course in 1936 and went flying in number one squadron, where we had Bristol Bulldogs. One of the tasks of the Bulldogs was to do meteorological flights. That was taking off from Laverton, flying up to 16,000 feet by 2,000 foot stages, and taking the temperature, and then eventually coming down. These aeroplanes that we flew in had no radio, virtually no instruments, certainly no navigational aids. And so often when we went into the overcast, we didn't know where we were when we came out. So these were quite dicey flights in a way, but they taught us a lot about finding your way around with no instruments and in very bad weather, which stood me in very good stead in later days when I was flying in perfectly foul weather in Britain and in the tropics where we had the intertropic front. In 1938, I was posted back to Point Cook to do a navigation course and also to convert to seaplanes as part of that. And you got introduced to water, which is a totally new environment to operate in. Then on to seagulls, which are most ungainly, heavy, uninteresting aeroplane to fly.
Brayton Davis was another graduate of Point Cook.
I said, I'd like to fly flying boats because I was a yachtsman. And naturally, I thought towards the sea. And they sent me off to Rathmines, the country club, which was known as the country club. And I learned to fly the Warras. And the pilot on the Australia was due to be replaced. So I was selected to replace Weber on the ship. The aircraft was sitting up in a catapult. I'd never seen a catapult before in my life. The catapult's at 40 feet. So it's a big climb up to the aeroplane. So eventually you climb up and hop in, and then everybody's aboard, and you start the engine, and then they extend the catapult to 90 feet. And this puts you over the edge of the ship, and you then proceed to run the engine up at 2,500 revs. And when it's up at 2,500, you drop your hand. There's a guy standing there with a flag. And he drops the flag, and the guy down below pulls the bloody trigger. And you're fired off just like a gun. All I knew was we were suddenly in the air. I didn't know anything else. I thought, we were flying. When you land, the ship appears to be right bang in front of you. And I thought we were going to just fly straight into the ship. But anyway, we didn't, we stopped. And we came up and we hurried up to the ship and we were hooked on and up we went. And we did this about three or four times. And then they said, well, you better have a go. When I spoke to my friend afterwards, he said, oh, Brayton, he said, you're as white as a sheet.
Queensland and Northern Territory Aerial Services, better known as Qantas, was registered in Brisbane in the November of 1920. The new company became airborne 2 months later, when two of the principals, Hudson Fish and Paul McGuinness, took off from Mascot in separate aircraft and flew to Winton in Queensland. With good support for this new form of faster public transport and an agreement to carry domestic mail, the Outback airline grew and by 1931 was trialling airmail flights with the British Imperial Airways. Mail from Australia was now reaching London in just 16 days, less than half the time taken by the Ocean Service. Government tenders invited applications by aviation companies to run a new passenger and mail service connecting Australia and England, and Qantas and Imperial Airways were successful with a combined bid. They then formed a new company under joint ownership called Qantas Empire Airways. QEA ordered five de Havilland 86 aircraft for the new service, specifically designed for the airline to carry the mail and 10 passengers between Darwin and Singapore. In February of 1935, Qantas made its first international flight from Darwin to Kupang in Timor in the Royal Mail airliner Canberra. The 10-day service between ends of Empire was such a success with letter writers that before long mail volumes were exceeding available storage space on the aircraft. A solution to the problem was provided by the British government, who in 1933 had requested aviation manufacturer Short Brothers to design a big, new long-range monoplane flying boat for use by both Imperial Airways and the RAF. Partner Qantas agreed to the British initiative and undertook to purchase six of the new aircraft out of an initial British order of 28.
Centaurus makes big flying boat news. When commanded by Captain Burgess, she prepares to leave Southampton on her 30,000-mile survey flight to New Zealand. Hers will be the longest trip ever undertaken by a commercial aircraft, and she'll be flying over the proposed air route to the Dominion and back.
Before continuing on to New Zealand with the proving flight, Centaurus visited Brisbane in December of 1937. George Roberts had joined Qantas the year before, at the age of 26, to overhaul and maintain aircraft instruments.
Because there was a great shortage of airfields at that time, but it needed something in the form of a flying boat. Short Brothers then came up with the Empire C-class flying boat. The reason for the name C was that they were all named after the letter C, but they were technically known as the S-23. The size of it, compared with what we were working on previously, was something that really got me. It was so commodious. It had several cabins in it, but not only was it spacious, but also it had a promenade deck where people could get out of their seat and walk over to the window. And seeing that it had also a high-wing monoplane, it meant that it had an umbrella over the top of you, and the sun didn't shine in your eyes, and so therefore the vision of the earth below was exceptionally good.
Qantas air and ground crews went to school, learning the secrets of handling the giant British flying boats, soon to strengthen the link between Australia and the motherland. Master aviator Scotty Allen, fresh from a special instructional course in England and backed by thousands of hours in the air in war and peace, passed on his vast knowledge and experience to the up-and-coming pilots, preparing for the inaugural flight from Australia.
My duty is one of the greatest in its imperial and Australian significance, which it has been my privilege to perform since my appointment as a representative of His Majesty the King in Australia.
Acting Governor General Lord Huntingfield handed over the first mailbag to Captain Lester Brain. He cut the ribbon to open the service, and 4 tons of mail at 5.5 a half ounce were off on the 9-day flight.
The Camilla is on her way, and we all join with the distinguished guest present in wishing her Godspeed and a safe voyage.
In July of 1938, just 1 month after the inauguration ceremony, QEA's first Empire flying boat, Cooey, arrived at Rose Bay to pick up passengers and mail and commenced the first of 3 services a week to England. Qantas also moved its operating base from Brisbane to Sydney at this time.
When we first arrived, there was no hangar available to us. There was no slipway. The aircraft had to be serviced on the water. What they did build and allowed the passengers to be boarded aboard a launch and taken to the aircraft was a ramp running down to a floating pontoon.
Good morning, madam. Welcome aboard.
Although we started the service in July 1938, we did not have a hangar until September 39.
The first voyage by Cooey to Southampton was to involve 9-night stopovers over the total distance of just over 13,000 miles. The first stop would be at Townsville, followed by Darwin and Surabaya, before handing over to an Imperial crew at Singapore. Then on to Bangkok, Calcutta, Karachi, Basra, and Athens before arriving at Southampton on the 10th day. The Empires were the first all-metal aircraft in the Qantas fleet, and passengers reached their destinations at a maximum cruising speed of 150 miles an hour. It was expensive, though. The journey through to Southampton cost £200.
And to sit in the cockpit of the flying boat was quite awesome compared with my early training on Tiger Moths and the airspeed Oxfords. And we carried a captain, first officer, only 2 pilots, no navigator, no flight engineer, but a radio operator. And all the communications were done by Morse code.
William Davies joined Imperial Airways as a flight steward in 1938 and flew in the C class as a company passenger on several of Imperial's Empire routes.
It was a first-class aircraft. It was a large cabin and a galley amidship, and next to the galley there was a purser or flight clerk. He was the one who's responsible for all documentation and passenger lists and journey log. He was responsible for all that. And he had a little office with a desk and a typewriter. He used to type the menu and he helped the steward during the meal service. But it was first class glass, silver and china. And first-class hotels, Shepherd's in Cairo, Grand in Rangoon, Raffles in Singapore, the Great Eastern in Calcutta. See, they were all first-class hotels. Everything was excellent.
The other aircraft type ordered for RAF employment at the time of commissioning the Empires back in 1933 was the Short Sunderland. The prototype came off the production line in October of 1937 and by 1938 had entered RAF service in Singapore and Pembroke Dock in West Wales.
Are all the hatches closed?
Yes, okay, Pam.
Okay,
Developed as a long-range maritime patrol aircraft, the Sunderlands were armed with top, rear, and bow gun turrets, carried 2,500 gallons of fuel, and could operate usually with a crew complement of between 10 and 13 over a maximum range of 15 hours.
Skippers, no sugar.
I collected the first Sunderland we had in the squadron from Rochester. The Sunderland, of course, was the pinnacle. And work away from base, you could really do it in comfort. And of course, even the luxury of a flush toilet, let's face it, you know, to have that on a RAF aircraft was something out of this world.
When Australia was going to pick up Sunderland aircraft in Britain to bring them out to form number 10 squadron in Australia, I was one of the 9 pilots to go over there to bring them back in 3 lots of 3. Yes, it was quite a big deal, flying from very early morning till early afternoon and then stopping over at various places. We had 12 very interesting educational days in an Empire boat, which was virtually the same as the Sunderland that we were going to fly. We went over to Britain in July 1939 and converted to bigger flying boats and then on to Sunderland, all very easy because we were very experienced pilots. They were easy to handle, they flew long distances, they were comfortable. The grace of the flying boat was something, a joy to behold. And about that time, there was a threat of war, and it was patently imminent. And the Australian government had promised Britain that they would provide an air expeditionary force in the event of war. The war came a little earlier than Australia expected. It could have provided the squadrons, but not the aircraft. So a deal was done with Britain. You keep those 9 Sunderlands over there, and number 10 squadron would operate as an RAAF squadron in coastal command in Britain. And so, as of the beginning of war, these pilots, augmented by further pilots who were flown across, started operating very early in the war on anti-submarine patrols.
Among those posted to 10 Squadron were Point Cook pilot officer graduates Atty Wern and Vic Hodgkinson.
I jumped on the C-class boat with old Scotty Allen was the skipper. It took us 2 days to get over Australia.
Well, the first thing, of course, when we went to England, we arrived in January and we left here in Australia in the middle of December, or end of December, it was very hot, and we went to Calshot, the 3 of us I'm talking about now. The Solent was freezing over at that time. None of us had ever seen snow before in our lives.
Freezing air over you all the time. We didn't have any greatcoats, so we gave us a pair of greasy old overalls each.
We did first off a conversion course at Calshot with the RAF.
They used to let us take these scarpers out and around just for taxing practice. And we always tried to get in early for lunch because you had to walk all the way from the hangars up to the base, which was the best part of a mile, I suppose. And we were the last aeroplane in. So we're stuck at the end there on this aeroplane. Flush in the marine section, which was on the end of the pier, was about a mile away with the oil stamp trying to get them to come out and pick us up. And the crew and the aircraft alongside us were doing the same thing.
Ahoy, 476, right side.
And someone on that crew put a red cartridge in the Vera pistol and booped it off. And this thing arced nicely through the air, looked beautiful, and then lobbed on the next scarp and sent the light. Then all hell was let loose. Boats going everywhere. Nobody picked us up. We still didn't get any lunch because it was too busy.
And then we joined the squadron at Mountbatten, which was a beautiful base on Plymouth Sound. And that's where we operated for the first 9 months or so. And then we moved up to Pembroke Dock for a period of time. In fact, we were bombed out of Plymouth and went to Pembroke Dock. And then when things quietened down a bit, we came back to Mountbatten. At the same time we were at Mountbatten, we had a detachment up in Oban on the west coast of Scotland. And we operated there for about 9 months with about 3 or 4 aeroplanes.
We went out and located our convoys, which was quite a remarkable thing in this foul weather and with virtually no navigational instruments at all, no radio aids at all because there was radio silence. Having got to your convoy, you then did a search,
spearing ahead of the convoy, then doing searches either side. And the main aim of the exercise was to keep submarines down. Submarines, if they were seen, they'd duck down. And this stopped them following the convoy. Now, seeing a periscope in the rough waters of the Atlantic, or even on quiet days when there was no wind, you didn't see many.
Everybody had to be alert all the time, searching for submarines. It was a boring job, but the boys on in the upper hatches, they would only do about an hour or 2 hours out in the slipstream with their helmets and everything on, with binoculars scanning the horizon all the time for hours on end. The main object was to keep the submarines' heads down so they couldn't get out to the convoy areas. The fact that they had to keep their heads down meant they were only doing 4 knots underwater maximum.
Still, still!
On the surface, they could do their maximum speed, 8, 10, 12 knots. We used depth charges, and we would drop those from about 50 to 75 feet maximum height. And the idea was to get down low and hope we could hit them.
Sometimes you'd see oil, but there was no guarantee that submarine hadn't just released oil as a foil to say, well, we're sunk, and you press on and do something else.
In later months, or later years for that matter, the submarines tend to stay on the surface and fight back. And we lost a lot, our 10 squadron, we lost a lot of aircraft after that.
As the German offensive continued through Europe and Italy joined the Axis, commercial flying became too dangerous, and the Empire through service to England was cut. Despite some ominous signs, QEA continued on with the Sydney-Singapore service.
Qantas then were asked to fly not only to Singapore, but right through to Karachi. Imperial Airways then picked up the service again at Karachi. They then flew on to Cairo and then down to Durban. And so was formed the Horseshoe Course.
Ken Mears was seconded from the RAAF and posted to first officer duties on the Horseshoe route.
But one thing I don't know if the passengers were aware of, that the drill that if you landed anywhere and you lost a float, the passengers were handed a life jacket and asked or pushed up onto the top of the main plane to go out on the far end of the wing where the good float was to stop the other one getting in the water, because once it went, the wingtip went in the water, it would fill with water and you'd roll over.
Australia's famous navigator P.G. Taylor brought in the first PBY-1, and the British Air Ministry and the United States government commissioned him to survey an alternate Empire air route across the Indian Ocean in case Japan captured Singapore.
Designed for the peacetime U.S. Navy in the mid-1930s, the PBY Catalina was destined to enter the flying boat record books for the highest number of aircraft manufactured, more than 3,000 over several model variations. It was very popular because of its versatility and extreme long-range ability, up to 28 hours of continuous flight, courtesy of big fuel tanks in the 104 feet wingspan. The trade-off was that it was also very slow. The designation PBY meant patrol bomber, and Y was US manufacturer Consolidated's identification letter. After modifications for military use were carried out at Rose Bay, two Empire flying boats began service with RAAF 11 Squadron at Port Moresby in September of 1939.
Normally used for reconnaissance flights, but the flying boats can back up their signals to ships with something more than words if the occasion calls for it. The planes are similar to the Sunderlands, with which the Royal Australian Air Force Coastal Patrol Squadron has been chalking up such a good record in England since the war began.
A year later, two more of the Empires were attached to the squadron, joining with the carrying out of search and reconnaissance missions and the delivery of service personnel between advanced operational bases in the Pacific.
They were military airplanes of a kind, but they did sterling work on reconnaissance for a start and then on evacuation.
By this time, some of the Qantas air crews were now wearing RAAF uniform.
In 1940, Australia was almost bereft of operational aircraft of any consequence at all. And it was decided to place an order for some Catalinas.
The new Catalina flying boats were required to be flown back from the consolidated factory in San Diego, and Qantas alone had pilots trained for the extra disciplines of long-distance flight. Aviators of renown seen here at San Diego before the initial Pacific ferry flights are Captain Lester Brain at second left, Captain Scotty Allen at right, and Captain P.G. Taylor at right.
But these were going to be reconnaissance aircraft that would attack submarines, if any, and armed merchant cruisers. That was their recce role, and that's what they were brought out here for. When the Japanese came, it was our aircraft that picked them up for a start as they were moving down towards Rabaul. And the first of our cats that did that we shot down, and the crew spent their time as prisoners of war in Japan.
And then one day, their bombers were escorted by fighters. And this is where the plot thickens, because that meant there was an aircraft carrier there. The fighters couldn't come from any land. It was an aircraft carrier, there was a fleet. We were flying along and told to search for a fleet. Well, that's like asking you to look for a hornet's nest. So we searched for the fleet. We found the fleet, and the fleet shot the Christ out of us.
We were Ethelred the Unready, we really were. And we were then told that we were Australia's very long-range bombing force. So these Catalinas were stripped of any non-essentials, like the armour plate to protect crews, so that they could take off and go as far as possible north to see when the Japanese were coming down, then later to carry the maximum bomb load to attack Rabaul, Gasmata and other places where the Japanese were had occupied.
Back on the other side of the world, at Plymouth's Mount Batten, one major challenge had nothing to do with the enemy.
Rather a crazy operation, really, because you weren't in touch with the base apart from emergency signals, because if you transmitted, we're afraid the Germans might locate where you were, sort of thing. It wasn't so bad flying out over the sea in the bad weather, it was coming back.
One night we went out when Britain closed down totally with fog, and we lost from our command in coastal command 2 Sunderlands, 4 Hudsons and 8 Anson aircraft, all of whom had been out during the day and they couldn't get back.
And I got caught out one night and they didn't recall me, and because I finished up in the money drink and broke my back and all that sort of thing.
For crews in emergency situations, there was the thoughtful provision of a very old communication method.
And 3 engines had gone. It was just the main plane, really, still floating. The rest of it all broken up, each end. We were sitting there and a bit stunned, and one chap said, "What's that bloody thing?" And at the trailing edge, which was a little wash, was one of our pigeons. We used to go 2 pigeons. And somehow they'd broken out of the cage, and this poor old pigeon was covered in bloody oil and stuff. And he was there, shivering like mad.
The Duke of Gloucester recently visited coastal command stations of the Royal Australian Air Force, whose squadrons are serving with the RAF in Britain.
Number 10 Squadron was joined in coastal command by another RAAF Sunderland Squadron, number 461, which commenced operations in 1942 from Plymouth Mount Batten, before moving to Pembroke Dock in West Wales during 1943.
The 461 Squadron was formed on Anzac Day, and it was called the Anzac Squadron. And we didn't train flight engineers in Australia in that time, so our flight engineers were British.
They taught me how to play poker. Expensive lessons, but well worth it.
The RAF was a bit officious in, yes sir, 3 bags full.
I don't think I ever heard anyone calling anybody sir in the Australian squadron. And we're all known on first name terms. And I thought this was grand. This was really nice.
Both the Aussie squadrons were concentrating patrol activities over the Bay of Biscay, the main access point between Europe and the United States for Atlantic convoys and the preying U-boats. The German Luftwaffe substantially increased fighter support for its submarines in the area.
We couldn't cope with Junkers 88s and stuff like that. They'd hunt in packs of 8 or 16. Most of the Sunderlands were shot down, they got engaged with them.
So when you're attacked by the Ju-88s, which of course are much faster, you would slide under and get down to sea level as quickly as you could, and then you were well protected from above.
The British made a film in 1942 about the operations of RAF Coastal Command. In this scene, a German aircraft is attacking an RAF Sunderland, which has requested urgent escort assistance from Coastal Command, and an Aussie crew have been deployed to help.
Hold it, Navigator. We found them. There's a bit of a party on.
Action stations, everybody. Get into all positions.
Action stations. In we go.
All characters shown in the film are played by serving Air Force personnel.
Here come the Aussie boys. They'll help us out.
Another hazardous activity for flying boat crews was air-sea rescue work in bad weather. 461 Squadron Skipper Gordon Singleton alighted in big seas to pick up some downed airmen and later offloaded them and half the crew when a destroyer arrived at the scene. Because of the poor conditions, the Sunderland was taken under tow by the destroyer until a mooring bollard broke. This left two options: either scuttle the aircraft or attempt a dangerous takeoff. Skipper Singleton chose the latter.
And finally, as my navigator said, we had one hell of a wave hit us underneath and broke the seal with the water, and we went into the air. And in the takeoff, the sea had torn a hole something like 2 meters long by a meter wide in the hull, which obviously made it impossible to make a normal sea landing. So from there, we had to decide what to do. And I said to them, well, we got an angle aerodrome just handy. We could land on the grass there. And they all said, oh, good idea. So I had to think, now, how the hell do we carry out this landing? And it was logical that we should make it on grass rather than on the tarmac. So we picked the best piece of grass we could see on the aerodrome, and we touched down. Went gently for about 100 yards and just tilted over onto one float, and that was the only damage that was done, apart from the blinking great hole. The wing commander had organized an ambulance for us, anticipating the greatest crash ever. And the doctor came with the ambulance, and we were all loaded into the ambulance, driven into Pembroke, and stopped at the pub, which was shut. So the doctor got out, knocked up the pub owner, and said, I've got some characters here who've just landed, Sunderland on land, they need a pint desperately. So he opened up for us, and we had a couple of pints.
The rapid Japanese advance left many people stranded in the path of the invasion forces, so the Air Force and Qantas mounted urgent rescue missions. The first loss of a flying boat occurred when Corio was shot down on her way to collect refugees from Surabaya. Of the 18 passengers and crew aboard, only 5 survived, including Captain Aubrey Kosh.
And 2 of our boats did an incredible job picking up people right under the nose of the Japanese, bringing them back to Samurai, and then down to safety.
The numbers of people that they evacuated are not known, but they ran into thousands of people, particularly wounded, being brought back to Australia. The last aircraft to leave Singapore was laden with as many people as they could get aboard it.
Captain Bill Crowther took the last Qantas flight out of Singapore. His son Graham, seen here at Leff with his father, remembers him relating his Singapore evacuation experience.
But approaching Singapore on his, before he actually went into Singapore to take that last flight out, he discussed with the crew whether they were happy to do it because it was a significant risk in undertaking the venture, and they all agreed 100% that they were, yes, no doubt about it, we've got to do it.
The same Japanese strike force that devastated Pearl Harbor attacked Darwin on the 19th of February 1942. The Qantas Darwin hangar was a write-off, but the Empire flying boat Camilla survived the attack because of quick thinking by Qantas captains Crowther and Hussey, who removed her to safety from the burning harbour.
Following that, the evacuation was taking place from Java over to Broome. Now, that was successful until the very last aircraft. They carried as many people as they could into Broome. And the last aircraft to leave there, Bill Purton was the skipper of it, and they left Java and were never seen again. Then, of course, the enemy raided Broome and sunk all the aircraft that were on the water there at the time, including two Qantas flying boats. One of them was Centaurus.
Qantas international flying boat services were cancelled with the fall of Singapore, badly affecting the company's viability. The fate of the airline would hang in the balance unless another overseas route connecting the Empire could be found. Captain Bill Crowther had a suggestion to make.
My dad just looked at the operational feasibility of operating through Perth and Ceylon and approached Hudson Fysh about that, and the idea was taken up, and he was asked to go and to run the operation out of Perth.
The Empire flying boats didn't have the range for the more than 24-hour non-stop flight, and there was only one aircraft that did. The RAAF couldn't help out, so the British government agreed to loan Qantas 5 RAF Catalinas for the new route, which began secretly operating from Perth in August 1943. The service carried mail, official documents, and the occasional important passenger.
It was a whole new experience, of course, well for everybody in Qantas. Captain Bill Crowther being appointed manager of Western, was called the Western Operations. It was a very ambitious program, really.
Flights departed the Swan River before dawn and flew across the Indian Ocean to Ceylon's Lake Kogala. All flights were completed in radio silence because of the threat from Japanese fighters, and passengers were awarded double sunrise certificates in recognition of their time aloft.
BOAC then asked them not only to fly to Ceylon to land in Kogla Lake, but also to continue on to Karachi, where they would connect with him, and once again the horseshoe course was reinstalled.
And then we'd go on to Karachi. That was about a 14-hour flight, just overnight Karachi, and providing that the southbound aircraft, which was being flown in from by BOAC, was on time, we'd take that off to Lake Kogla.
The longest flight was just 4 minutes less than 32 hours, and the average flight was 28 hours, 35 minutes. And those Catalinas did 271 crossings backward and forwards, and without loss of person and without loss of aircraft.
There were now four RAAF Catalina squadrons deployed in the fight against the Japanese. Air crews of numbers 11, 20, 42 and 43 squadrons were conducting bombing, mine-laying and torpedo runs, as well as carrying out ocean reconnaissance and the transportation of Special Forces personnel. Operations were mounted from RAAF bases at Cairns, Corumba, Darwin, Melville Bay and Rathmines on the shores of Lake Macquarie, which was established in 1939 as the RAAF's sole sea training base.
It started off calling it a seaplane conversion unit, but then became number 3 operational training unit. It had marine craft based there, and we also had number 9 squadron, which had Sikorsky aircraft. Then we had the Dorniers, German aircraft, but they were from the Dutch Air Force that came to Rathmines. But it was a real patchwork quilt of aircraft. But no one gave Catalinas the credit that was due to them, that an aeroplane which was designed to take off from closed harbours, ranging out over the ocean looking for an enemy submarine or an armed merchant cruiser, should suddenly be transmogrified into a very long range bomber or very long range mine layer, or even worse still, torpedo dropping, tasks for which they were not designed. For that reason, the people accepted this as normal, but no one gave Catalinas the credit that was due to them for the incredible task that they performed day after day, night after night, from before when the Japanese came into the war till after the Japanese were defeated.
6 of the 9 Sunderlands, originally ordered by the Australian government in 1938, finally arrived in March of 1944 and began transport work with RAAF 40 Squadron, running supplies and personnel between their base at Port Moresby and Townsville. One skipper made a serious misjudgment when alighting with a full load at Townsville.
And apparently he touched down with his load of troops and decided he'd tax his aircraft on the step into the harbour. He misjudged it, and that was the end of that aircraft.
By the end of European hostilities in 1945, members of 10 and 461 squadrons had attacked and destroyed 18 U-boats out of a total of 190 destroyed by Coastal Command during the war.
There were a lot of losses, no question. Too many, and of course if a crew is lost, there can be a dozen bods gone.
After the Allied victory in the Pacific War, a massive airlift involving land planes and flying boats was mounted to return service people and prisoners of war to Australia. Air Force nurse Lorraine Vines was at home near Sydney Harbour.
I was standing on my veranda at Darling Point, overlooking Double Bay, and they came into Rose Bay. And they came one after the other. They kept coming.
At the end of the war, Qantas had one flying boat left only, and the name of it was Coriolanus. It immediately set up a service from Sydney to Brisbane to Noumea to Fiji and then back the same way.
My father had been offered a job in Fiji, and because the government were paying, we went from Rose Bay to Suva by flying boat, the Coriolanus. And it was just, all these years later, it's just one of those moments that are sort of indelibly inscribed in my brain. The sun was just starting to come up. The first glimmers of light were sort of illuminating the waters of Rose Bay. And one by one, these huge Pegasus radial engines start whoom, whoom, whoom. Then he opened the throttles, and boy, was that a moment. There's this great roar, and the plane sort of seemed to sit back on its tail, and this foaming water just suddenly came over the window. We were underwater, and we roaring along down Rose Bay, and gradually the water was decreasing down the window, and then I saw the float, and it was suddenly off the water, and then suddenly there were a few bumps and lurches, and we were airborne.
The trip to Fiji took 2 days. We used to overnight in Noumea. And that was pleasant because you had a nice French meal there.
Noumea was the way that the majority of expatriates would be getting back to Australia and sending children back to school.
And then eventually, late in the day, we descended into Fiji and we had the whole thing in reverse, this plumes of spray on either side and then taxiing into the quay, and there were some friendly Fijians saying, "Ola, welcome," you know. But it's one of those experiences that I will never, ever forget. Wonderful, magical.
Coriolanus was built at the Short Brothers factory on the River Medway at Rochester in Kent. Registered with Imperial Airways, she took her first flight to Australia in June of 1937. When Singapore fell in 1942, cutting the through service to England, Coriolanus was caught on this side of the world. With agreement from Imperial, she was Australian re-registered and QEA assumed ownership. Coriolanus was then put to work transporting service personnel. By 1947, she was not only QEA's last Empire flying boat, but the last operational Empire in the world. All of Imperial's inventory having been lost by this time through enemy action or mishap. Since beginning work connecting the ends of Empire 10 years previously, Coriolanus had clocked up 2.5 million miles of safe air travel.
Coriolanus was taken off the run, and then nothing seemed to happen for some time.
They pulled her up on the deck, and it sat there and did nothing.
There's a photograph we still have here of it being decommissioned there in the hangar, and they came for the last time, and a group of people seeing it off.
And the next thing was that Captain Crowther was presented with the instrument panel out of the aircraft, and she was to be broken up.
I don't know why Qantas would not sell it to me. I went to buy Coriolanus, and it was being offered for £200.
And had he wouldn't allow it, and had the aircraft destroyed, it was operational.
If we had nothing to do, waiting for aircraft to come in, we'd go out and dismantle stuff out of Coriolanus, pull all the wiring out.
As much as I wanted to, it was not available to me. It was just scrapped, and Sims scrap people came out with their axes and actually just cut it up with axes. They actually still on the wing, chopped off a piece of wing and then another piece of wing and so on, and then it was just scrapped.
But fancy having that aircraft today, be absolutely fantastic.
Lancaster military land planes were converted for civilian use, and as Lancastrians, they took over the Qantas Catalina double sunrise flights to Ceylon in 1945. Imperial Airways had by now evolved into BOAC, the British Overseas Airways Corporation, and the original England route via Singapore had been resumed, with Hythe flying boats replacing the Empires. Originally built as military Sunderland Mark III's, the Hythes had extensively modified interiors for passenger comfort. But travellers now had a choice, either travel by Hythe flying boat to Southampton over 9 days, or a Lancastrian to London via Karachi in 4 days. Seen at right with the dog in this Rose Bay Group photo, Dudley Tunks was a traffic officer for QEA.
One thing that was different, having only 15 passengers, if the passengers requested it, they were picked up by a hire car in the morning and brought to the airport in a hire car. We used to weigh the passengers, had a big jockey scale in the office.
A typical passenger list would include sort of military people, there'd be admirals and air marshals and generals and senior policemen and...
senior government people, and we carried diplomats. Then we carried businessmen.
Security people. That was something Imperial didn't talk about very much. They preferred to talk about the sort of glamorous Indian Maharajas and the Duke and Duchess of Devonshire.
Australian Prime Minister Ben Chifley was lucky enough to be in the care of BOAC steward William Davis.
Well, when we were approaching Darwin, he said to me, "I have to get off here." I said, "Why do you have to get off?" He said, "Well, you know, there'll be a guard of honour and all that business." I said, "Well, you don't have to get off." He said, "Yes, I do." I said, "You're the Prime Minister. Nobody tells you what to do. You can go to bed. Your equity can make your apologies and congratulate them on the reception and promise them they'll have a longer stay on the return journey." He said, "Yes, I can. All right, I'll go to bed."
Alan Tibou joined Qantas in 1946 as their first ever cadet steward. His initial job was looking after 21 Hythe passengers on the Singapore run.
Now, during flight, the boring times, couples would find the bunk upstairs. So we would look after them appropriately.
What does that mean?
Draw the curtains? Draw the curtains, and do not disturb sign was out for a while. But while there was no in-flight entertainment in those days.
But there was always a possibility that the pleasures of first-class cruising could be rudely interrupted.
Between Bowen and Darwin, we rarely served a meal, which helped us, because you were flying at 6,000 to 7,000 feet over all the thermals in Australia if you could get. So most passengers just curled up with an air sit bag and just hoped that they could get to Darwin. But also in the cyclone season, because we couldn't get to the altitudes, we had to go through a lot of heavy weather. And that was some really scary stuff.
Together with flight engineers and navigators, radio officers like Jim Delaney were integral members of flight crew.
Every half hour you'd report in by radio, give your position. I liked the aircraft. There's only one aspect of the flying boats which I detested immensely, and that was having to do the mooring. And as soon as it was on the water, you pulled the hatch back and put the bollards up and got the drags ready to go out.
To get steerage from the flying boat, you put out canvas drags and you push them into the water at a certain angle so they acted as a big bucket, if you like, and on the captain's direction, whether he wanted to turn to port or starboard, you put that particular drag in and gave it a degree of bite in the water so the captain could use asymmetric, the opposite engine, if you like, and to swing the engine, the aircraft around.
Early in his Qantas flying career, Colin Howe was also a radio officer.
It was a problem on occasions for the aircraft to get airborne because flying boats suffered from the actual suction of the hull to the water. In some occasions it was quite difficult and indeed had to be abandoned until a later time in the hope that the wind would get up and ruffle the water.
By the end of 1947, the first writing appeared on the wall for the long-distance flying boat. Qantas purchased six Lockheed Constellation 749 aircraft, and the first Connie service on the Kangaroo route to London started by carrying 29 passengers and a ton of food parcels. For a short period of time, the new Qantas aircraft ran in tandem with the Hythes and Lancastrians. BOAC had not yet replaced their fleet with post-war designed aircraft. There were now a lot of ex-service people returning to former employment or seeking new ventures. Many war surplus aircraft became available for sale by tender, and at Rathmines, Catalinas and the five Sunderlands of the now disbanded 40 Squadron were sitting on the water waiting for buyers.
And I asked to be taken out on board, and of course the minute I got on this magnificent aircraft I fell in love with it, and I thought I might buy one or two of them, and because the Catalinas were being sold for £1,000 each, and I thought perhaps they'd be sold for about the same amount and I might buy two of them and somehow start some sort of an air service. But of course when I went into the Disposals Commission I found out that I couldn't buy just one or two, I had to buy all five.
And Brian made a bid and got himself five Sunderlands and 35 spare engines for £10,000, I think it was in those days.
I thought they might be an investment, but in the end, I found that the only alternative I had was to start an airline.
Brian Monckton was one of three enterprising wartime pilots who were integral to the establishment of post-war commercial flying boat services. Captain Stuart Middlemas formed a Barrier Reef Airways in Queensland when he bought three Catalinas from Rathmines at £1,000 each and converted them for civilian use. Captain P.G. Taylor, who was to join Brian Monckton in his new airline venture, was renowned for his pioneering of aviation routes, which now included the first crossing of the South Pacific from Australia to Chile in the Catalina frigate Bird II. before meeting Brian Monckton in Sydney's Union Club during November of 1947. John Pote was an RAAF wartime Spitfire pilot based in the Mediterranean. He accepted an offer from Brian Monckton to join him as co-pilot on a transoceanic flight to Lord Howe the following day.
Got into a Sunderland for the first time, sat on the right-hand seat, and did what I was told. It appealed to me very much. Flying a flying boat is so different from land planes. But in a flying boat on a mooring, the moment you start one engine, you're moving. So it's a completely different operation. You have to work out before you start the engines which way you want to turn, where you want to go. In those days, there would be four or five aeroplanes moored at Rose Bay. You'd probably have to make your way up through them. There'd be the land on one side, depending which way the wind was blowing and which way the aircraft were lying. No water rudder. You steered with the engines. We operated into the Clarence River at Grafton. Then you'd find yourself with the current as well as the wind to cope with. Much more interesting than landing on concrete and taxiing and putting the brakes on.
We started with a route to the Solomon Islands, through Noumea and the New Hebrides.
Very exotic places in those days, with very little white civilization there.
We started the Lord Howe Island service. We operated four times a week to New Guinea, about four times a week to Hobart, and various routes like that.
We went to Tahiti twice in 1948, which was historic because we were the first Australian registered aeroplane ever to land in Tahiti itself.
When Transoceanic Airways started, the government told Qantas that they had to enter the act, and Qantas didn't want any part of flying boats, but it was forced on us by the, it was still government owned then. So we got Catalinas.
The reason for the Catalinas, they were the ideal aircraft to fly through the island and maintaining a connection between all these places.
Under normal circumstances, the Qantas Cats carried 14 passengers. But there could be variations on this number.
They used to put such a load in them, you know, the hull was shaped like that over the top, and of course the cases would leave that much room, you know, up the top, and they would put the natives in there, stack them in, and all you could see would be white eyes.
Well, we used to carry 33 in Port Moresby, 33 natives. You'd all get on board and taxi and take off. If you looked around, I could see my head. When I looked around, they looked at me to see what I was going to do, and they all had their sick bag there, 33 of them. The Catalina was a pretty rough kind of an aeroplane to fly. It used to leak if you flew through a storm, they'd get wet.
Flying at about 500 feet, it was raining cats and dogs, and sitting up in the flight deck of the cockpit with my great overcoat on, and saying, God, I wish someone would blow this bloody aeroplane up, and I'd go back to DC-4s. And that was the night that our aircraft was sabotaged.
The usually calm waters of competing commercial flying boat interests became very choppy when a Qantas Catalina was destroyed by explosion at the Rose Bay Wharf after returning with Captain Ashley Gay from Lord Howe. An element of good luck existed in that no one was hurt. But it was a very serious attack on Qantas business interests. Brian Monckton was later charged with being responsible, but lack of evidence produced an acquittal by the jury, and he continued with his airline operations.
It was a promising going concern until about 1951-52, and financially it became a disaster around about then.
I didn't know you could borrow money from the bank. I didn't know you... all sorts of things that a normal commercial person would know. I was very naive.
And TOA just ceased to exist, which was a shame. We'd all put a lot of hard work into it. After that, the only thing that survived was the Lord Howe Island service, because it had to have a flying boat service. There was no airstrip.
Barrier Reef Airways had been acquired by Ansett Flying Boat Services which also gained Transoceanic's assets when the company folded in 1953. A major inclusion in this for Ansett was the right of use to the Rose Bay base. The BOAC flying boat terminal at Southampton farewelled its last aircraft in 1950, and subsequently a number of BOAC boats were advertised for sale. Captain P.G. Taylor responded, went to England and bought a former BOAC Sandringham flying boat for £20,000, named her frigate Bird 3, and began adventurous South Sea Island tourist cruises. After a few years of successful sole operating, costly difficulties associated with starting a new service from Hawaii resulted in the selling of his beloved frigate Bird 3 to a French airline in 1958. Ansett was now the last Australian flying boat operator, all other routes having been replaced with land planes. The essential service to Lord Howe Island remained the exception, but business at the Rose Bay Water Airport was now a lot quieter, with just two Sandringhams, the ex-Qantas Pacific Chieftain and Beachcomber. Flying boats had always been particularly susceptible to bad weather at their moorings. Indeed, many had been lost this way. Pacific Chieftain suffered an ignominious end when she was washed ashore at Lord Howe in 1963. She was refloated, but sank again in another gale and had to be written off. A replacement aircraft was found in New Zealand, which was lucky because flying boats had virtually disappeared from passenger routes the world over. After conversion at Rose Bay, she was named Islander and began a 10-year link with Lord Howe in 1964. There was a hiccup after just a few months of operation when Islander nearly suffered the same fate as Pacific Chieftain when she was blown ashore. Fortunately, the damage was limited, and with a lot of help from residents and passengers, together with a maintenance team, Islander was eventually refloated and returned to business. The end of the commercial flying boat era occurred in 1974, when the construction of Lord Howe's new airstrip was completed and land planes took over the service.
Today, newer aeroplanes and economics have forced the flying boat service out of business. Once a hive of activity, the Rose Bay hangar is now deserted and silent. Flying boats are still in demand around the world, and to take delivery of the last one is Captain Blair, who, with his famous actress wife Maureen O'Hara, runs a service in the Virgin Islands, and he's renamed the craft Southern Cross. The Sandringham starts up its engines on Sydney Harbour for the last time as it moves out on one of the longest journeys of its life. Watched by a nostalgic crowd, Southern Cross lifts off as another page in the history of Australian aviation is turned.
2 months before leaving Sydney in the former Beachcomber, Charles Blair had purchased Islander, renamed her Excalibur, and flown her back to his base in the Virgin Islands. Blair was killed in a flying accident in 1980, and subsequently both the former Ansett boats deteriorated through lack of maintenance. They were later sold to cover debts, and Southern Star was bought for £85,000 and installed as an exhibit in the Southampton Hall of Aviation, which was purpose-built to receive the aircraft. Skipper Vic Hodgkinson then led a dedicated team in restoring Beachcomber to her original livery and name.
So we've got the engines going. In the meantime, you're juggling the aircraft, taxi down the channel or between ships and things. You're doing all sorts of things at the one time. Not like a land plane. You just start the engines up and you've got nice brakes and things to stop. And you stick hard back. As the aircraft got up under the step, you ease this stick forward to the central position or thereabouts to get the aircraft in a planing condition. And let the speed build up to takeoff speed. You use the stick gently back and it came unstuck from the water.
The former Islander was purchased from Onteal Airways by a British businessman
and was based at Chatham until being sold to the owner of an American aviation museum. After proving trials on the Solent, she left in 1993 for the flight to her new home in Florida. She is the very last of the operational Sunderlands, though the British Imperial War Museum at Duxford and the RAF Museum at Hendon both have Sunderlands on static display. Next to the Sunderland at Hendon is a Seagull 5, number 824, which was in RAAF service from 1936 until being sold to private enterprise in 1946. In the High Street at Pembroke Dock in West Wales, there is a plaque presented to the people of Pembroke by members of RAF 10 and 461 squadrons, dedicated to the fellow airmen who did not return. On the water next to the former Pembroke Dock Coastal Command base, the old fort houses a military museum which includes flying boat memorabilia among the displays. Commemorative plaques record the era. And Rose Bay RSL plays host to the last surviving item from an Empire C-class flying boat.
Certain aspects stick out. And then at reunions, now if somebody mentions something, now this is when all the stories come out, at a reunion. I mention something which reminds him of something, which reminds him of something.
The worst weather I ever struck in the Air Force wasn't up north, wasn't around the China coast. It was out of breath mines.
My only claim to fame was to have navigated the longest scheduled airline flight in the history of aviation. 31 hours, 51 minutes.
You'd be keeping the Japs up all night. And they were so browned off about this whole thing that one of the, I think Tokyo Rose, said that if any Catalina crew were ever caught, they'd be beheaded.
And they landed in the Brisbane room with the other carriage down.
While they were still flying, everyone's writing, well, now I know people are writing to the paper saying they're making too much noise coming over Vaucluse and all the rest of it. But when they stopped, everyone was disappointed. They all rode in and said, you know, the greatest thing around the place is gone.
Aside from the memories and photographs of the people who played a part in the golden era of the flying boats, there is little remaining from their time in Australia today. P.G. Taylor's Catalina Frigate Bird 2, in which he and his crew flew across the Pacific to Chile, is an exhibit at Sydney's Powerhouse Museum. The RAAF Museum at Point Cook has lovingly restored to pristine condition a former Air Force Seagull 5 flying boat that was wrecked and subsequently lay icebound in Antarctica for many years. After a prolonged absence from Australian skies, a Catalina was purchased by local enthusiasts and brought back from Portugal. A quick paint job, and Felix the Cat now entertains spectators at air shows and commemorative events, highlighting the crucial role that the RAF Catalina Squadron air crews played in the Pacific War.
To join a flying boat was almost like going on board a ship to start with, and then you took to the air, and it was a very exciting thing to do, I think, for passengers.
I've spoken to quite a few people that used to fly regularly on them, and they said there was just something about it that really was intriguing.
You fly so low, you could see the sea and the waves, and if anyone offered me something special to do now, to do a reproduction of that flight, overnighting on the way and flying that low, it would be just fabulous.
They even had reunions, you know, a year afterwards. They'd all come together again at, you know, at a hotel somewhere and relive the experience of that journey, which sort of engraved on their minds in a way that an aeroplane trip today just isn't. You know, you do it and 24 hours later you've more or less forgotten about it.
It represented a more leisurely time, I feel, particularly with contact with passengers, where, you know, you're dealing with 30 passengers or thereabouts, and not today like it is with 300 plus passengers.
I had the feeling that this was something that was just going to go out of existence, and it was such a wonderful experience. The feeling of landing on the lagoon, this beautiful turquoise clear water, it was just such a fantastic feel.
They're expensive to run and maintain, as any person that owns a boat will know. Anything to do with seawater, you get corrosion and that sort of thing, and they took a lot of maintenance as opposed to a land plane.
They became ill in a flying boat, which was tossed around. They became ill in a DC-3 and a DC-4 and all the rest of it, which flew up around 10,000 to 12,000 feet. But once you got up to 20,000 feet, you got a much smoother operation altogether. That's the difference, the big difference that took place with the pressurised aircraft.
People say, you work on the flying boats?
Yeah.
Oh, what are they like, you know? Have you been up in one? Yeah, many times. Yeah, it was just, yeah, probably the best time of my life.
It was the best fun of my life, I would say. It was far, far more interesting than land plane flying. It was more personal.
I enjoyed it. I had a wonderful time.
Oh, five of the best years of my life, I'd say.